Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship on this All Saints Day. If you can hear me okay, would you give me a thumbs up? You can hear me okay? Great. Well, welcome to you all. If you want to follow along in our bulletin today, that should be on our website, sancarloshtlc.org. We won't have any of the words put on the screen this morning, so it'll be following along from your bulletins. That's sancarloshtlc.org, where you can find that. That's all the announcements that I have. If you would like to, let's prepare our minds and our hearts for worship with our prayer. We begin with our invocation. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Amen. Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives, and we rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you have provided enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in the newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us now live in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. O God, generous and supreme, your loving Son lived among us, instructed us in the ways of humility and justice. Continue to ease our burdens and lead us to serve alongside him. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from Micah 3, chapters 5 through 12. Thus says the Lord concerning the prophets who lead my people astray, who cry peace when they have something to eat, but declare war against those who put nothing into their mouths. Therefore, it shall be night to you without vision, and darkness to you without revelation. The sun shall go down upon the prophets, and the day shall be black over them. The seers shall be disgraced, and the diviners put to shame. They shall all cover their lips, for there is no answer from God. But as for me, I am filled with power, with the Spirit of the Lord, and with justice and might, to declare Jacob to his transgression and to Israel his sin. Hear this, you rulers of the house of Jacob and chiefs of the house of Israel, who abhor justice and who pervert all equity, who build Zion with blood and Jerusalem with wrong. Its rulers give judgment for a bribe. Its priests teach for a price. Its prophets give oracles for money. Yet they lean upon the Lord and say, surely the Lord is with us. No harm shall come to us. Therefore, because of you, Zion shall be plowed as a field. Jerusalem shall become a heap of ruins, and the mountain of the house a wooded height. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 1 Theologians chapter 2, verses 9 to 13. You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day so that we might not burden any of you when we proclaimed to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was toward you believers. As you know, we dealt with each one of you like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. We also constantly give thanks to God for this, that when you received the word of God that you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as what it really is, God's word, which is also at work in your believers. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, do whatever they teach you and follow it. But do not do as they do, for they do not practice what they teach. They tie up heavy burdens hard to bear and lay them on the shoulders of others. But they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. They love to have the place of honor at banquets and the best seats in the synagogues, and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and of all the peoples call them rabbi. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all students. And call no one your father on earth, for you have one father, the one who is in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Would you please join me in prayer? Merciful and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be reflections of your love. Amen. So I think it's no surprise to anyone here that I've been thinking a lot about the election happening in just 48 hours. It's more prevalent in the election season, but I've noticed that people who are so thoroughly entrenched in their own political ideology, they tend to see their candidates as people who can do no wrong. Or if they do wrong, they dismiss it with this logical fallacy. It's called tu quoque. It's the logical fallacy that says, you can't attack our side because your side does it too. It's like a counterpunch is, well, you do it too. What a world we live in. We can't have a discussion about values without it devolving into some kind of ad hominem attacks. Something crazy happens to us when we become infatuated with the people in power. Sometimes we refuse to see what's wrong and we put on blinders with ours. Why do we do this with people who hold power? Maybe it's because we assume that those who hold those positions, they're uniquely capable. Maybe we're trying to control our own fragility or the chaos in the world. Supporting our people in power makes us feel good. It's nice when our candidate wins. It makes us feel like we're safe if the person we choose gains the position of power. The funny thing is I actually believe God created us to be this way. Those inclinations we have are actually given to us by God, because God created us to be in relationship with God's self. We were created to respect God's authority and power. We are created to seek after God because God alone is capable and has the power to deal with our own fragility and the chaos in the world. Our devotion to political leaders, to people in power, people who think they have answers, well, they're ultimately misplaced. All of that was meant for God and for God alone. Early in the history of Israel, They had judges who ruled over them. And they went to God and they asked for a king to rule over all of them. A ruler they could follow, that they could feel safe with. They looked at the surrounding kingdoms, and so they went to God asking for exactly what they saw. God sees this as a rejection of God. So God tells the prophet, the people have rejected me as sovereign over them. God says elsewhere, they have done this from the day I brought them out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods. God knows what will happen when we seek after human leaders. It's not going to go well for the people. God warns them that by taking on a human king, that king is going to do all kinds of bad stuff. God tries to get his people to see that when you put all of your trust in human leaders above God, it doesn't end well. The Hebrews, they felt this need to put their devotion under someone in power. They felt the need to feel safe by having a leader they chose. They wanted someone who could still the chaos in their souls and in their lives. And they wanted this instead of going straight to God. What they're really seeking is relationship with God, and they replace it for someone in power. The word for that is idolatry. And we do the exact same thing today. If you think your political candidate has done no wrong, then it's time to reevaluate your devotion. Because there's only one person on earth who has not sinned. He wasn't a politician or a person of great wealth. He was an immigrant, dark-skinned Jewish man who was killed for teaching about love. Jesus himself levels heavy criticism in our gospel reading today about people in power. He calls them out on their hypocrisy. They themselves didn't practice what they taught. He calls them out on their legalism. They put heavy burdens on others, but not themselves. He calls them out on their pride. They sought love and public recognition. He calls them out on their arrogance. They liked the respected titles that were given to them. And he calls them out on their greed. They establish laws only to benefit themselves. It shouldn't surprise us that Jesus has these criticisms of those in both political and religious leadership of the day. What he's dealing with is nothing new. God warns God's people that when they put their trust in leadership outside of God, stuff like that is going to happen. See, we have this natural inclination to seek out and support authority figures. But we have to be honest about who they are. They are flawed and sinful and messed up people. Friends, we're looking for stillness, for security, for home. And we're not going to find that in an earthly leader. What we're looking for is God. St. Augustine says, "You have made us for thyself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they find rest in you." So, my dear family of God, having political leaders and people in power is necessary. But let's keep them in their proper place. It's God who alone can give us safety and security. It's God alone who we can trust to be righteous. And it's God alone who is worthy of our whole devotion and life. Everything else will leave us wanting. Amen.
Now we read the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father and Mother Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father and Mother, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Gracious God, you invite those who feel most unworthy of love, to a seat at the head of your table. Through the humility, vulnerability, and repentance of your church, bring a compassionate welcome to all in need of your grace. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Sustaining God, guide all people of the earth through harsh extremes in the cycles of creation. Drought and monsoon, blistering heat and freezing cold. Hold in your mercy all places where lives have been disrupted by natural disasters. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Sovereign God, gather our country around a shared table this week during our national elections. Open fruitful dialogue between people of every political party, place, age, and socioeconomic status, so that we may discern the common good you desire for us. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Merciful God, protect those whose human dignity has been denied and oppressed in our nation. Raise the voices of those who have been silenced and bring justice where power has been abused for personal gain. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Loving God, accompany those in new and unfamiliar places who need an invitation to community. We pray especially for those who have recently moved or started their first year of college, a new job, or a missionary position in another land. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Eternal God, unite all the faithful in a banquet of your abundance. This day we remember all who now feast in your eternal presence, especially those who have died in the past year. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until the day that when we gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen. Well, the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
I would recommend that we just kind of wave to say peace to each other. The only announcement I have, and if anybody has an announcement, they can write it in their chat box in the Zoom, and maybe Anne can tell me, and I can say it out loud as well. The one announcement that I do have is next week we are meeting in person again, and we're going to be meeting outside. We had a lot of people show up last time, which was really great. So if you could all just let me know whether you're coming, this way we can kind of get a gauge of where we want to meet, whether it's still on the patio or maybe some more room up in the parking lot. That would be really great to know how many people are coming. So just shoot me an email. It would be really nice if you could do that. And do we have any more announcements on the bottom there? No? Okay. This is now our time of offering. Where we would usually pass plates, but I'll just say that there's ways to give to our church. The front of our website is sancarloshtlc.org. We have a PayPal button that you can use. We get checks in the mail. Simply giving is also an option where money's automatically deducted from your bank account. All these ways, we just encourage you to support the ministries of Holy Trinity, and I'm so grateful for all you who continue to do so. So thank you. Do we have any more? Did anybody write an announcement? Okay. We continue with our offering prayer. God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts, that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song. Amen. If you'll be receiving communion with us today, I'd invite you all to take your wine and bread and or grape juice and put it next to your screen so that we share a common table. Remember that Jesus is fully present with us in each of the elements, whether it's one or both. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
To the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks. And he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let's pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Come now to the table of our Lord, for he has prepared all things. If you are receiving communion alone today, I'd like to serve you now. This is the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. If you're with other people, I'd invite you now to serve each other. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in his grace. Amen. Receive now the benediction. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. Almighty God bless you with grace, mercy, and peace now and forever. Amen. God is with you. Thanks be to God. And we will see you all at coffee hour, everyone. Thanks for coming.